Good morning. It's my privilege to introduce Dr. Beverly Copper, the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater Provost and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs. Dr. Copper has demonstrated a deep commitment to supporting our thriving entrepreneurial ecosystem. She is a transformative leader committed to breaking down silos and the strategic allocation of resources. The Provost has committed her time to supporting student entrepreneurs and has committed the funding necessary to allow us to develop new initiatives, to foster applied student learning, nurture entrepreneurs, launch and grow small businesses, and engage in meaningful outreach, economic development, and activities that extend beyond the borders of our campus. Dr. Copper has been instrumental in providing leadership and funding for our student entrepreneurship through the Whitewater Incubation Program. These programs allow our students to engage in high-impact practices that create graduates with a globally conscious economic worldview. Provost Copper was also a champion as we developed our bid to serve as the host institution for the U.S. Association for Small Business and Entrepreneurship, a successful endeavor that ultimately allows UW-Whitewater to serve as an entrepreneurial nexus in the region. It is truly my honor to introduce Provost Beverly Copper.
Good morning, and I too would like to personally welcome you to the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater. We are absolutely delighted that you are here this morning. Our university is a place where entrepreneurs from every corner of campus, business majors and professors, artists, teachers, social scientists are creating new companies and inventing new technologies, helping to build a stronger Whitewater and a stronger Wisconsin. Our student, faculty, and staff entrepreneurs have shown time and time again that with a good idea, passion, lots of hard work, a little luck, and people along the way willing to support them, great things do happen. We are delighted to have with us today an entrepreneur who has pursued his diverse passions in life, found great personal and professional success, and who has also supported others along the way, Mr. Steve Kaplan. Mr. Kaplan's first business venture involves something all of us in Wisconsin are all too familiar with, shoveling snow. He was 10 years old at the time and eventually sold his business for $48. Years later, Mr. Kaplan became a self-made multimillionaire who built, bought, and sold more than 100 businesses. As a sought-after inspirational speaker, he has helped thousands of people identify and realize their dreams. He is a best-selling author, Tony Award-nominated producer, mountain climber, he's run with the bulls in Spain, been diving with sharks, accomplished what many others only dream of, and engaged in more adrenaline-producing activities that most dream of avoiding. And he still finds time to coach his kids' Little League team. We're honored to have him share his experience and wisdom with us this morning. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Steve Kaplan.
Please welcome Steve Kaplan.
Give yourself a chance at luck.
Nothing is better in business than passion. Give them a chance to catch on to your star.
Being here.
Thanks.
You can work with these people, understand their plight, and make their life easier.
Well, I really believe there's two speeds. Either you're going forward or you're going backwards. You really aren't standing still.
A man from Chicago's northwest suburbs shares his wealth on ABC's Secret Millionaire.
He grew SCA, a marketing company, from startup to more than $250 million in sales. He played a key role in selling Snyder Communications for $2.1 billion.
The guy retired when he was 39. So, I've listened to what he has to say.
I made $18 million on it. I was 22.
People say do what you like, and I'm a big proponent of that. But the reality is, if you do something and you're making huge cash at it, guess what? You like it.
I have brass books.
Congratulations, you're on the New York Times bestseller list.
got to be creative. You can't be like everybody else.
How are you going to do it? How are you going to make it happen?
I miss the battle you guys are going into. I'll be real honest with you.
Steve co-produced the musical Leap of Faith, starring Brooke Shields and Raul Esparza. Steve is also a producer of the upcoming album titled Chi-Town, to be distributed through Universal Music Group and Def Jam Records.
Without the risk, you don't really get the big reward.
I'd like to give a check for $100,000.
Proceeds from the event benefit three Chicago area organizations.
For your amazing gift and your amazing generosity, thank you, Steve.
There's no doubt one man can make a difference. Silent, take my hand.
Thank you. Thank you. No. Thank you so much for having me here. I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak with you. Talking at universities is one of my favorite things to do. I just got done with a tour of last year about 25 universities, and I'd really want to congratulate UW-Whitewater. You guys have got an unbelievable entrepreneur program here. It's great. The state-of-the-art facilities, and I've been everywhere all over the country talking to all kinds of schools, so be proud of that. You're in the right place for what you want to do. So let me ask you guys a question here before I start. Right now we're all in here and you know, trying to get a little focus on and listening on business and entrepreneurship. How many of you have a call that's in the back of your mind? Or you got to check with home later? Or maybe you're making plans later on to do something? Or anything else that's not business that's in your that you've been thinking of? Let me get the right clicker here. Is this right here?
Yeah.
All right, thank you. This is what happens. There is no difference between our life and our business. That's one of the most important things that we need to understand in the world of entrepreneurism. You are your business. It is what you do. It is integrated with your life. It is integrated for the things you're doing. You're on the golf course. You're at a meeting. You've got your phones. Technology makes it so there is no separation. The things that you want to do are distinctly interlinked with the things that you are doing. And when you accept that, things would get a lot easier for you. Because you're at home, you're doing things at night. You wake up at, I do this all the time. You wake up at 2 in the morning with something that you've been thinking about, and boom, you write it down. You know, these are things that happen, and when you can do that, then you can really pursue the things that you really want to do more than anything else. And it's funny because, here we go. Because Beth mentioned something about that first business that I had, and I was fortunate enough that at an early age, to figure out what I wanted to do, just in one of these things. And this is the inspiration for my first business that Bev talked about, which was the Viking snow shoveling. I was a big football guy, and even though I'm a Chicago guy, my mom got me a Minnesota Vikings uniform when I was a little kid because it was probably 10 bucks on sale at Toys R Us, I think. But that was the inspiration for it. So, when he had his first thing, everyone knows about the snow here. So my neighbor, Jeff Wexler, and I got together, and we had this big company, and it was called Viking Snow Shovelers. And we'd go out, and we would work like crazy. And it's like, you're shoveling snow back then there wasn't even any power shovelers. In there, it would take 2 hours to do one house for like $3. But we were smart enough, I don't know what made me think of this, but we had people sign like little contracts, like just a little one-page little thing. It was no big deal. At the end of this first snow season, Jeff said, I'm out. Probably said, oh, I'm out. And I said, me too, definitely out. But instead of just saying, forget it, what I did, I was at my friend Tony's house and having dinner there, and his dad was a contract landscaper who did all the, a lot of stuff outside the highways. And landscaper, he also had a snow shoveling company, big one, commercial one. So I ended up selling him, as Beverly said, I sold him the contracts that I had for $48. And man, it was unbelievable. I was on cloud nine. I remember getting on my bike and running to Kim's Drugs and buying $48 worth of baseball cards. It was the greatest thing. And as time goes on, it's that passion for doing the things that you like to do. Every time I went to work at the name of Viking Snow Shovel, I had this football mentality, and I was getting touchdowns and all this stuff. And that stayed. And I encourage all of you as you grow in your businesses, find things that you love to do. And it's a very, it is a totally cliche, find your passion. And everyone says that, and it's so, such a marquee thing to say. But if I could say it the other way, the things you're doing every day, you might as well do something that you love. I mean, it's the same effort. And you're going to be so much more happier. And the thing is, too, is that you can make money at anything you do. So find the industry, find the business, find the thing that you like. And it takes a while. So if you don't find it, you know, my children are in university right now, and they're freaking out because they don't know exactly what they're doing. I'm like, it takes time. You don't have to have it today, you know, and just go with it. For me, you know, it wasn't the first business that I really grew that really went crazy was a company called SCA. And what that was it wasn't a cartoon company, by the way, but it was a little marketing company. And I grew it, and I grew it, and I grew it, and I liked it. It was really successful. But I found out what I really loved was the business of business. What I loved was leading people, growing businesses, getting strategy. That's what I loved. It wasn't the marketing. It wasn't the advertising. And we got huge. We built this thing. You know, it was $2 billion and 50-something countries and 3,000 employees. And we were a publicly traded company. All that started from my garage. But the thing that I loved about that wasn't necessarily even the what we were doing. It wasn't the product. It was the growing of it. And it took me a while to figure that out. So stick with it if you're not exactly sure what you want to do. Because if you're willing to be flexible, which most of you are, you're going to find your way. And it's going to just be great. You're going to be really happy. One of the things that I consider myself very fortunate about is that I've been able to be surrounded by a lot of really successful people. And I've noticed that I've kind of distilled this down to like kind of four DNA traits or four characteristics that I really find in a lot of successful people. And I want to share those with you guys today. And I want to talk to you in terms of some of the situations that have happened to me in the past. These are the same things I just got. I was fortunate enough to be able to go to Afghanistan and talk to our troops about getting businesses and starting businesses. And it's the same things that I noticed that are inherent in the military, which is kind of an interesting thing. So the first characteristic is tenacity. You got to stick with what you're doing. I mentioned that first company that I started was the Sampling Corporation of America. And I put this picture here because this was twice my company. This was the result. This is the company, everybody and their spouses or significant others, so it was half of that, so about five of us, on a trip to Cancun. We were there because the other employees had agreed to not take any salary for 2 months because I had no money to pay them. So as a leader, as your leader, as your business, you know, why would somebody do that? They would do that because they believe in your passion. They believe in what you do. They believe that they're part of something bigger than a job, you know, a calling. And lucky enough, you know, the revenue came in. Everyone got paid, and as a reward, you know, we all went to Cancun. And I'm the goofy one, third from the right in the hat, but I'll do that real quick. So about tenacity. You're going to have a lot of bumps in the road when you get out there. And this is one of the biggest ones. This is the biggest burn and the greatest lesson I ever learned at a young age for like $200. The business, as I said, was small. This is at a time where I would sell companies in the Northeast. I'd drive down the New Jersey Turnpike because a lot of packaged goods companies were there. And I didn't have a lot of money to take everybody out. And, you know, we had nothing, basically, at that particular time. So what I would do is I would rent a big car, and I would sleep in the car outside of a Hyatt. Why a Hyatt? Because they had big bathrooms I could clean up in the morning and put my one suit on every day and go do my thing. So money was a little tight back then. I was in Chicago. I got a call from, this is Lever Brothers on Park Avenue. I got a call from this guy and said, Steve, we love your program. It's a marketing program. You know, we're very into doing it, into going. And I was like jumping up and down. I was so excited. Okay, I'll be there tomorrow. You know, I hop a flight. I get there on a Friday. And you know, he says, "Go ahead, let's go out to lunch and talk about this." I was probably 21 at the time, and I'm saying, "Oh, that's great!" One of my first business lunches in New York City. So he took me here. This is Smith and Walensky, right? On like 42nd and Park. I mean, to walk in, it's like, you know, I don't know. It seemed like a fortune to me at the time. But we sit down and we're talking, and this guy's ordering like he's going to the electric chair. It was unbelievable. And here I'm sleeping in my car, and this guy's like ordering drinks and steaks and all this stuff. And he's telling me in between shoveling food, yeah, you know, send me a contract tomorrow. I'm like, oh my God. Now I start firing all these orders up and everything, and it was just awesome. It was on a Thursday. I get back Friday, said, okay, well, I called in. I said, hey, overnight, FedEx this guy a contract because he's ready to go. Send a contract, you know, a couple days later, I figure I'll just check. I call up the guy, hey, is Glenn there? Glenn doesn't work here anymore. Really? Yeah, Thursday was his last day. I was his goodbye party. Is that unbelievable? But it's interesting. I know, and that was beyond livid, believe me. But it was one of the greatest lessons you could, for $200 back then was a fortune to me. But what did I learn? You know, keep your highs not so high, your lows not so low. And first and foremost, nothing is anything unless it's in writing. Nothing. And you know, it's funny, to this day, I never forget that. But the greatest thing later on is that about 10 years later, my company was smoking, man. We were, you know, we went from sales, I think, well, startup, really, for nothing. And our sales were probably, I don't know, maybe 800 million back then. I get some guy, one of the guys who was working for me, said, I got some guy I'm thinking of hiring. It was him, right? It was the same guy. So it's funny. That's the other thing, you know, be good to people because you never know what happens on the other end. So after I got done working, I decided I wanted to share a little bit I have. I wasn't really fortunate. There wasn't programs like this out there for me. Kind of had to learn on the fly and make a bunch of mistakes. So I thought I'd write a book. And at that particular time, you know, I could have gone into a bank and probably, you know, borrowed a couple hundred million to start a business. I couldn't get the assistant to the assistant to the assistant of a literary agent to call me back. No way. Because I had nothing in that industry. So I put forth the lessons that I put in my book here, and I went out for myself. And I went and I narrowed down on a publisher, and I just went and I hit this guy, and I sold him, and he finally agreed to publish the book. And it's just like lessons that I had from things that I've done. With tactical things about selling, a lot of it's selling. And it's interesting, because I told the guy, you know, I don't even want an advance, I want a bigger back end. So I believed in what I was doing, and that's how I got him to say yes. You know, because it's hard to get publish a book, it is, especially today, because it's a very risky endeavor for them. So this is the first book was the one, was Bag the Elephant, up in the top middle. And I'm like, you know what, I don't even want an advance, but I'll take a bigger back end. And I want the book promoted. So it went out there and it did good. It made all the bestseller lists. It did great. And, you know, it turned out that it was not a good move on his part to make that deal, but it worked out good for me. But it's the tenacity. And that's the point, is finding a way. If it doesn't work for you one way, go the other way. Go, if a door is closed, go a window. Keep going. Keep focusing on what you want to do. Second thing that I find in successful entrepreneurs is they're resourceful. They find a way. And it's funny. This is one of the greatest things that I learned, and a lesson that I tell entrepreneurs that they can take away right now and use immediately. Businesses, your big customers, you know, are like little countries. Everybody has their own language. It's the world of bureaucracy out there. And one of the things you do when you have your own business is you get your own nomenclature, you get your own terms, you get your own words, your own acronyms in there. But the thing is, language is a funny thing. We're sitting here in Whitewater talking English. If this whole thing was in Prague, maybe next year, Pat. But and if we're sitting there drinking a beer in a cafe in Prague, we stand out, right? We're not local. But if you learn the language, if you're trying to sell big companies, or you're trying to get into a new industry, if you learn their language, what do they call things? Then you're an insider, and it happens immediately. And this, I put this up because this is probably one of the funniest things, but it literally meant millions to me. I was at Procter & Gamble, and I was sitting in a lobby like everybody else, waiting, you know, to be graced by someone we could try to sell to. Happens all the time. I went to get a drink, picked my head up, and smacked my head on this sign. Obviously, it wasn't too high up, but I cracked myself with the sign. I look at this, and I don't know what hit me at that particular time, but I just tried my next meeting. Instead of saying, hi, this is Steve Kaplan from so-and-so, I would like to meet to talk to you about our stuff. I said, hey, this is Steve Kaplan. Listen, I'm going to be in SW4. You got a couple minutes to come on down and do this? And the guy goes, yeah, no problem. And I tried it again and again, and my hit rate was through the roof. And the reason I found out was they didn't really know, you know, I positioned myself as an insider because I used their term, SW1. So who else did I do business with there? They didn't know. The fact it was nobody, that doesn't really matter. You know, I mean, it was good for me. But these things are all around us. When you're out there and you're in the world and you're an entrepreneur and you're looking in your industry, be aware. You know, it's not just, you're not just there selling and talking about what you want to do. You're there listening. So, you know, you may say the same thing five different ways to five different people because they have five different companies or five different industries. You know, it's not about what you want to say. It's about what they want to hear. And that little nuance is the difference between success and failure many times. So the takeaway here, even this and a tactical thing, is learn the language. When I was talking to publishers, learn the language. Later on, I got into television producing and music producing. Learn the language. Be an insider on those parts of things. And people that have been lucky enough to be successful have that ability to do that. Also adaptable. This is one of the funniest things too. I had so many crazy things that happened. This is when my business was just starting out, one of my first business. It was a promotion company, and we had the opportunity to do this thing with Hershey Chocolate Company. And they agreed to come to our little office, which was good. It made us clean it all up and everything. And we were pumped. We were working until probably 3 in the morning, putting the finishing touches on our PowerPoint. And I came in the morning all revved up, not one, but two kinds of bagels and cream cheese, everything. Like, we really went all out for us. We went in this room, and we were like, I was all nervous because our company, we had nothing at this particular point. But we had an idea to do a promotion with the NFL, so a football promotion. Again, getting back to my love and passion, which is football, I try to incorporate that as much as I could. So we had this thing with them calling that we called the Big Pass, right? And that was it. It was for Hershey Chocolate Company. We sat down, we had this great title slide on there, and it was like this. There you go. And that's just Hershey Chocolate Company, right? So they always battle with the with the caloric issues of their product and everything like that. And what made it worse was this was burned into the template. So it was on every single slide the whole exact time. So it's funny. So after saying, yeah, you're reading it right, that's what we're talking about, you know, it didn't faze us. So being adaptable, being able to slide and stick and move to the things that you're going to come. There's going to be challenges. You're going to make screw-ups. You're going to mess up for sure. That's okay. But it's what you do with it and how you adjust to that. It's not a problem. We ended up getting the account. We got this person. It was a very important part of our business. And later on, went on to do many things with them. And I asked them, like, why in the world did you give this to us? You know, it was a disaster, this thing. And they said, very simple. It's the way you handled it. In that meeting, it was didn't faze you. It was no problem. We knew that if things came up during our promotion, we would be in good hands. You would be fine. So, you know, that's the thing. Again, adaptability is really important. Same thing with moving around. Once you decide what you want to do, these are some passion projects that I started, that I wanted to really do. And so I did a little show for ABC called Secret Millionaire, which I loved. It was a great show for me. You go undercover, you live there, you live in an area for a week, and then you look for heroes doing good things, and then you donate your money to them. And I met some wonderful people there. And one of the people I met was this woman, Diane Latiker, who was a CNN Hero of the Year, and she's a wonderful woman. And it was a group, she had a group called Kids Off the Block, and it was about high-risk teens and getting them out of gangs and stuff. And we met them, and during the show they had great talent as far as musicians, amazing talent. So, you know, what we did, I looked at what they had, and it's, you know, again, I'm talking about being adaptive and switching around. So what we did is we came up with a project, and we put them together, and that's the album right there, which is on Universal Music Group. It's coming out pretty soon. And we cut an album for them, and it was great. And they went out there, and they had so many things to overcome. But these group of kids were just focused and driven, and they didn't let no get in their way. So they went up to Canada, and they went with some producers, the guys that produced for Drake and some other people, helped them do this. And they made this killer album, and it's really amazing. But they had that entrepreneurial spirit, that DNA that I'm talking about. So it isn't just in business, it's in life as well. Same thing with Broadway. When I decided I wanted to go ahead, and I'm a big fan of Broadway, and I wanted to take the book that I wrote and make a musical out of it, which is kind of crazy. So before I did that, I figured, you know, I better learn what the hell I'm doing, because when I wrote the book, I didn't know. So I met with this producer out there that's did a lot of different productions, and they invited me to join this group and come up with this play, Leap of Faith, which was with Brooke Shields and Raul Esparza. And it was an amazing, amazing experience. And I saw that everybody in there had the things that they had to overcome on a daily basis were just incredible. How do you adapt to today's world? Broadway is very old school in terms of its marketing. You know, you have a sign on in Times Square, you have something on a bus, and you have something in the playbill. That's it. But, you know, so how do you adapt to today's world? We had to make the whole thing social. You know, we had to make it so that we pre-sold sales so that we could build community around there. And the cool thing about being adaptive in today's world is the technology lets you be there. It lets you can exponentially do things at a rapid pace. You're truly, truly only limited by your own vision and imagination. It's sort of amazing. It's funny because I remember maybe 15 years ago, we were selling ad campaigns that had all these integrated parts to it. There's no way we could have done it. It sounded good. But now that stuff can be done. So all the different things that you're doing, push yourself. Don't get comfortable. These are, for me, and I put these on there because these were all completely new areas. I had no experience, didn't know what the heck I was doing in them, but had to apply those same principles to. That's the same thing that all of you need to be doing and thinking about as you go ahead to, you know, to pursue your next vision. And the last characteristic, the fourth one, that is so important, preparation. Just like, you know, a lot of battles are won before they're fought, a lot of sporting events are done and won before they're played. It's because prepared. If you're not prepared for, so if you're just out there doing your thing, you know, you can't do it. That's why the education you get in institutes like this are so critical, because it's not necessarily about doing everything right. It's about limiting the things that you do wrong. And if you have a good basis for making your decisions and the things that you're doing, that's going to go far. You're going to make less mistakes. You're going to be much more impactful there. So, this was another ridiculous thing. I climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. I don't really know why. That was not smart, but it was fun. But so you have the physical preparation, but I equate that to the mental preparation that you need to do before you start a business. It's the same thing. You're sitting down and you're saying, okay, never really did this before. Got to research it. Got to figure out what's going on. Got to figure out how not to die out there, probably. Things with water and food and sleeping and weather, and it's four different climate changes. It goes from, it was 105 at the bottom and it was -4 at the top. You go through 104 different degrees of temperature. It's a lot of adaptability. It's a lot of preparation is needed. But the stuff that I did in business prepared me for that. So I call on you to look in your life, look at the things that you've done in the past, and say, where's this experience? I've had to think and prepare and do something. It could be something physical. It could be anything. It could be a project you had when you were a little kid that you were successful on. Those are the same principles that you're just applying in a bigger scale to business. It's the same thing. And the thing that people do, I think, too often is they get too in their head about it. You know, it's too much thinking. Too much thinking. You know, it's instinctual. And learn. If you're doing your thing, you have a great basis for what you're learning here. You're instinctual about the things that you're doing, and you're not so bullheaded to think you can't make a mistake, and you shift around and you move, you're going to be great, especially doing it when you're in your 20s. It's awesome. It's a little tougher, you know, when you're 104. The last point I want to make here is just on branding, and it's just an individual thing, and we all know this, but in today's world, you know, the kids in there, you grew up with it, but it's just an interesting thing to spend a lot of time talking to people about this, to understand that we are all brands. Every single person is an individual brand. You're Coca-Cola, you're McDonald's, you're you. And so what is your brand going to be? Are you going to be true to your brand as you build your businesses? Is it going to be what you are? I'm not telling you what it should be. It should just be you. So when you're doing things, when I work with a group, a wonderful group called Tiesta Tea out of University of Illinois. We just did a big raise of money for them, a startup company. And what they were going to do is go into this thing, like every other presentation, and talk to VC group and fund managers and try to be in their world, right? And like, guys, no. Why would you want to be their brand? Bring them into your world, your brand. You know, bring them, make them young again. You have a social brand, a cool brand. Let them feel and experience what that is. So we came up with this great idea. It was like a tea tasting kind of thing, social hour. They're a startup company. How much do they really have to say anyway about financials? I mean, not much, right? It's certainly no historicals. So better to fill your time with something fun. So got everybody together, great people in the room, and they brought it, and everyone had such a great time, and they lived the brand. They felt what that was. And it was more impactful than looking on a slide and seeing numbers anyways. And they did great. They oversubscribed by like $500,000. They didn't even take all the money that they raised. It wasn't just because of that idea. But that's being true to your brand. And by the way, if you choose not to do anything, that's your brand. It just is what it is. So, you know, that's what when I say follow your heart and the things it is, you can decide what you want to do. You can get credibility and build a credential in your brand, the thing that you like. What do you stand for? And then incorporate that, you know, as you go back, you know, in your business. So the last thing I want to leave you guys with, I put a website up. There's a bunch of free stuff on there. Don't buy anything. Click free stuff on the top. There's a lot of tools and things like to help you as you get in your business as well. So thank you so much for the time, and I really appreciate it. Thank you. Good luck.